I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Powerful verse, isn't it? So powerful. I want to make a disclaimer on this, that this is not my original thoughts. It's my original readings and my original interpretation. I think this is a great, great book, 23 Questions About Hell. People will ask you and try to get a debate out of you. And I told them in Sunday school, sometimes I got so wound up, I went in the flesh and argued with them. And I hope and pray now I can give them an explanation without any hesitation from the scripture. And then let God take care of the argument. It's something that I really struggled with. Why was hell created?
Probably because Satan.
Huh?
I said probably because Satan.
That's where he and his angels, that was made for them, not for us. Okay? Would you say that our leaders in our country are very mean people for constructing jails?
No.
No. That's the reason hell was constructed, for Satan and his angels, and the followers of his angels. And of course you got the answer right, no. If you'd said yes, I'd go, had a heart attack. It's your choice whether you go to jail or not, right?
Yep.
It's your choice whether you go to heaven or hell.
Amen.
Thank you, Bonnie. I need that. You know, some people do not understand that it is our choice. Deuteronomy 30:19, I call heaven and earth as witnesses today against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both you and your descendants may live. I want to tell you a little secret. Your children tend to follow in your footsteps. And sometimes, if you have a husband or a wife that are not Christians, your children, it's easier for them to do wrong than it is good. Amen?
Amen.
And I thank God that we have examples before our children. I don't care who it is, a neighbor, an aunt, an uncle, a cousin, in-law, outlaw, I don't care, that has put the Word of God before me. You know, every time I see Mallory, I think of Bonnie saying that she was her Sunday school teacher. You know, Bonnie, you know all that Sunday school teaching? It paid off.
Amen.
It paid off.
It was for the average.
It's an example you put before people. And you know, I am so pleased that young people follow. Well, why was hell created anyway? Well, I'm going to tell you a little secret. Jesus says, in my Father's house are many mansions. He goes on to prepare a place for you. If it were not so, I would not have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. That's his children. Hell was created for Satan's children. Now, we don't like to tell people that, do you? You know what? I bet you there's not 100 preachers in the state of West Virginia that would preach these sermons. I bet you. I wouldn't be betting, I'd just be taking your money. How many mansions do you know that are less than superb? Yeah. Well, let me tell you something. Hell is not superb. It's not a place you want to go. Hell is dark because God is light. God is not in hell. You know, people don't want to believe that. People just cannot get in their mind that God is light. Satan is dark. And if you don't believe it, look at some of your Satan worshipers now. They walk around dark, right? They act dark. And they do things in the dark. Hell is only death because God is life. God gives you strength. And John 1:4 says, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. When all this is over, don't worry. I think I've already got a spot. Because you can't remember all this. Well, I'm not saying you can, but you can. Hell is hatred because God is love. There's going to be many people in hell. There's going to be hatred. There's going to be cursing. There's going to be screaming. There's going to be everything that's not in heaven. It's not going to be a place that you like. In 1 John 4:16, it says, and we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. And he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. Let me tell you something. Mean people will end up with a mean place to go. I promise you. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he reap. Hell has no mercy because God is mercy. You know, mercy is something powerful. Mercy is something that we don't deserve. And God has provided mercy for us, hasn't he? He provided a way of escape. I want you to listen to something that I have heard over and over and over again. They say, Big Daddy, I really want to go to hell because all my friends are going to be there. You ever heard that?
Yeah.
Bikers say it a lot. Well, I'm going to tell you a little secret about hell. It's going to be dark. And everybody's going to be screaming. It's going to be hot. It's going to be smoky. And if you want to hang out with your friends like that, you're in trouble. See, we have a choice in our life, smoky or non-smoky. Hell is only weakness because Lord is the giver of strength. Hell is weakness. When we get down there, you think you're going to feel, if you're a non-saved person, you think you're going to feel, oh yeah, I want to go play badminton today, and all that torment and screaming and worms chewing on your kidney's sake. I want to tell you something. It's weakness. Your body keeps getting weaker and weaker and tormented and tormented. And it's endless suffering. My dad, he always said there's nights I can't sleep because I worry about people going to hell. Well, I was one. You know, I was on my way. I just sat there and listened to him. I heard all this. I thought, yeah, well, you know, he's an old man. He doesn't know anything for him. Let me tell you something. My dad was a very smart man. I only wish I would have listened earlier. But God had a reason that I didn't. You know, he had a purpose. If I would have gone through life, like I say, pussyfooting around, I might not have been able to preach the word without compromise. I think there are people who compromise the word these days because they want the congregation to like them. Let me tell you something. I love you enough to preach the word in that you, your family, your friends, your neighbors, your in-laws, your outlaws, they can be saved. And maybe you might be the one that can convey this to me. Hell is loud because my people will dwell in quiet, in a quiet resting place. Isaiah 32:8. You know, how many of you have ever listened to a hymn and it just soothes you? You know, I can sing How Great Thou Art, and I'm in another world. Or Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. It just, just lifts me up, yes.
When Mom was laying in the hospital towards her last, where she saw she was struggling from her breath, well, Carrie, my middle one, she turned to me and she says, Bonnie, can I sing for Grandma? She said, I wanted to sing for Daddy, and I couldn't do it. And she said, can I please sing for Grandma? I said, you certainly can. So a cappella, right on key, that little girl sat there and sang Amazing Grace for her grandma. And it was beautiful, and you saw the change on my mom's face.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, I can't sing worth a lick. And I'm going into a nursing home and sang Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound to people leaving this earth. That's what they wanted to hear. And they would have peace come on. Mm-hmm. And they would go into eternity. Peace. In hell, there's not going to be any Amazing Grace thing. There's going to be people who remember Amazing Grace. They're going to remember sermons that's been preached. Your memory's going to be great in hell. You'll remember every sermon some crazy preacher like me preached about turning your life over to God if you have. But there's not going to be a thing you can do about it. It'll be too late. Hell has no water because water is the rain from heaven. Deuteronomy 11:11 says, But the land which you cross over to possess is the land of hills and valleys, which drinks from water from the rain of heaven. You know, rain comes from the heavens. It's not going into the pit of hell. There's no water down there. There's no water breaks. And people take this very lightly. And I want to tell you something. Most people in churches today never hear this sermon. Ever. Hell has no peace because God is the Prince of Peace. We usually read this verse only at Christmas, but it's so important to read it now. Isaiah 9:6, it says, For unto us, a child is born, unto us a son is given, the government which will be upon his shoulders, and his names will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. So if there's not peace, then there's going to be torment, isn't there? God's wrath of hell. Boy, I would not want God's wrath on me. Do you think a God that gave his son to die for every human being in this world, every human being, is going to be nice when you reject him? Now, I want you to think about that. Because we're going to be out in the world witnessing to people that have never heard of hell other than in a curse word. Right? And you know what? God's not going to be happy if we reject his son. Deuteronomy 32:22 says, For a fire is kindled in my anger and shall burn to the lowest hell. It shall consume the earth with her increase and set on fire the foundations of the mountains. Hell is under us. It's going to be bad. We talk about global warming. That's going to be some global warming. It's not going to be nice. In Matthew 13:39-40, it says, The enemy who swallowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are the angels. Therefore, the tares are gathered and burned in the fire. So will be at the end of age. Talking about people there. You know, the Bible's clear about it, but sometimes we want to hesitate. We don't want to tell someone, you know. God's wrath. So Proverbs 27:12 says, A prudent man foresees evil and hides himself. He doesn't go into it. But the simple, or as Harry said, stupid man, they pass on and are punished. You know, some people just think hell is going to be a place to hang out, drink beer, curse, carry on. Well, there's not going to be any beer. You will hang out. You will feel like you're falling all the time. And you will be in punishment all the time, screaming all the time. Question number two. I love this one. I hear this. If I've heard it once since I've been the pastor of your church, I've heard it 50 times. When I'm talking to people, you Christians are narrow-minded. Isn't there more than one way to heaven? All roads lead to heaven. And my answer is no. John 14:6 says, I am the way, I am the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. You know, we're afraid to say, no, there is one way to heaven. That's it. You know, if I want to go to Florida, and I'm standing right here, I want to head north, right? Come on. There's, if I go far enough north, I end up south. Right? Isn't that right? Kenny, if I go far enough north, won't I end up going south?
Not the way I see it.
In other words, you're telling me there's maybe one way to get to Florida. Head south.
You can go north all you want, but you have to go south to get to Florida.
Goodness sakes. You know what? Why can't we tell people that when they ask us about being a Christian? Do we want to hurt their feelings? I'll try to find the nice way. I'll show you something in a minute. In Acts 4:12, nor is there any salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men which must be saved. You can go worship anything you want to, all you want to, but if you don't worship God and trust Him, you're in trouble. 1 Timothy 2:5 and 6, for there is one God, we don't like to hear that, and one mediator between God and men, that man Christ, who gave Himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. In other words, in due time, He's going to be honored. One way or the other, He's going to be honored. Now, I want to ask you this. Now, here's something you can ask simply. What would you do if a doctor said you had a specific disease and you're going to die? The only cure would be taking one specific pill. The only known cure. Would you refuse to take the pill simply because it's the only remedy? Come on, how many of you say, no, I'm not taking it? I believe there's another way. I'm going to chew dentine all week and I'm going to get better. No. I'm going to take Alka-Seltzer Plus. That'll cure me. No, I'll take cold and flu remedy. No, you would be grateful for the cure, wouldn't you? You have the choice of the medication or to refuse the pill and die. Is that not correct? Now here's the one that gets people. It's up to you to make the choice, not the doctor. I can tell you anything. Until God speaks to your heart and touches your soul, you tend not to believe what a pastor or a preacher says. But we need to trust God. We need to trust God. You know, the Titanic went down. Y'all heard about that, didn't you? And it was a great tragedy. When it reached the world, there was a major challenge of how to inform everyone, especially relatives, whether their loved ones were among the dead or living. Right? Y'all can remember this when you talk to someone. The White Star Lines in Liverpool, England, hung a huge board outside as cardboard. And it said, on one side, known lost. On the other side, known saved. Now, I'm going to ask you something. Could you appear on both sides of the board? No. You were either known lost or known saved. There wasn't any middle ground, was it? you can believe your own opinion or you can believe Jesus. Is that not true?
That's true.
And we have people that believe their own opinion. John 14, 6 again, no one comes to the Father, what?
By me.
That's it. See, if you don't know other verse, he can just stay and quote that one all day on all their answers. In Acts 14, 12, nor is there any salvation in any other, for there's no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. You can go to Allah all you want, you can go to Muhammad all you want, you can go to the devil worshippers all you want. There's only one name under heaven that gives you peace. What is it?
Jesus.
I love that song, Jesus. You know, make it peaceful. If I was going to hell, I wouldn't like that. Question number three. Wouldn't God be mean and unloving for not allowing a good person into heaven? How many people said, well, I'm as good as anybody down there at that Christian church, I'll tell you what. One of them parked in my parking spot one day and they didn't even ask me. They didn't even invite me to the upcoming dinner next week. They go in there and they never ask me to come to church. They're rude to me. How many people do you know that find an excuse to blame other people for them not accepting Jesus? It's easy, isn't it? I can remember me. Well, I'm as good as that preacher. He went out and slept with one of you women in the choir. Yeah, I used to say that. Because I knew one of them did. No, I just tell them, I'm good as they. I knew in my heart I was just as dirty and vile as anybody in the world. But you know what I wanted to do? I wanted to say, I'm better than the preacher. Well, you probably are better than me. I don't care. I love Jesus. And I love his flock. And I would not do one thing to ever hurt this church intentionally. You know why? Because I would be held accountable for it more than you would. Matthew 12:37 says, for by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. I want to ask you something. What if you say nothing? What are you saying? You walk to a kid and you say, did you take out the garbage? And he goes, mama goes away, she won't hear me, you know, she'll shut up, forget about the garbage. What's he saying? He or she saying? No. Isn't that right? If you don't say anything, you say no. It's either a yes or a no. If you say nothing, more than likely, you didn't take out the garbage, because here's what you'd do. You'd say, yeah, Mom, I took it out this morning. But Mom goes and checks the garbage can. Well, they did. If they go, you probably go check the garbage can and it is full, right? Eternity in heaven is not based on being good for two reasons. It's based on a relationship. And who's the relationship with?
Jesus.
Right. Jesus and God. And the Holy Spirit fills you. It's a relationship. And secondly, if you're going on whose standards are of good are we going to be referring to?
What?
Well, you know, I just say you're getting ahead of it now. I'm going to say, are you going to use your standards or are you going to use my standards? My standards doesn't mean anything. Yours doesn't either. God's standards certainly does differ, as his standards is much higher than ours. God's standards is perfection. We can't be perfect, can we? We try. We try sometimes. And we fail. But the only thing saving us, the only perfection we have in our life, is Jesus Christ died for our sins. Period. That's the only thing we have going for us. God's standards is based on a relationship, not with the world, but with him. I know people that belong to every group you can find. You know, the Salvation Army, Eagles, I can just go on. You're hunting a place to fit in. Let me tell you where I finally found out I fit in. With God. I was a fruitcake and he's the only one loved. You know, he loved me. I'm different. I know I'm different. But he loved me just the way I am. Let's look at an example. Suppose you knocked on the door of the most expensive home in the country and told them, I'm moving in with you guys. Hope you have a happy day. Big Daddy's coming in. I got my motorcycle I'll put in the garage. What kind of bed you got for me? What would they say? What do you think they would say? Linda's down there laughing. Right. What would they say? They'd say, no. I don't want this crazy man at my house. He's a nut. He rides a motorcycle. He dresses funny. Talks weird. They'd say no. You know why? You wouldn't expect someone to welcome you in their home. You have no relationship with them. Right? No.